The following broadcast by the Detroit Symphony Orchestra is the complete concert of Thursday, November 12th, which was recorded at the Henry and Etzel Ford Auditorium for presentation at this time.
The Detroit Symphony Orchestra is on the air. WWJ, the Detroit News, brings you another major weekly concert by Paul Perret and the Detroit Symphony. This is Les Martins, and after 3 weeks in our studios while the orchestra was appearing at the Wooster Festival and in other Eastern music centers, we're back now at our regular stand in Henry and Edsel Ford Auditorium in Detroit Civic Center. The concert is going to begin with Mr. Perret conducting the Bach Suite No. 2 in B minor. Then, for the first time with the Detroit Symphony, we'll hear a promising young violinist, last year's winner of the International Levantritt Award, Arnold Steinhardt. He'll play the Mendelssohn Violin Concerto in E minor. During intermission, we'll have a conversation with Mr. Steinhardt. And finally, a symphony of massive proportions will complete the program, the Symphony No. 5 by Gustav Mahler. It promises to be a fully satisfying concert. The focal point of Johann Sebastian Bach's life was the church. He wrote most of his perfectly staggering volume of music for the church. But after 9 years of writing exclusively for the organ, Bach accepted a post that required him to lead an orchestra and to compose music for it. It was during this period, around 1720, that he wrote the Suite No. 2 in B minor. It's one of four suites for orchestra. After a three-part overture, there are five old dances: rondo, sarabande, bourée, polonaise, and minuet. Except for the sarabande, which is slow and stately, all of them are quite light and infectious, as is the little concluding movement. The combination of Bach and Mendelssohn on the program is quite fitting, because Bach and his music were more or less forgotten soon after his death in 1750. A bundle of his cantatas sold for $40. The engraving plates of The Art of the Fugue went as scrap metal. The catalog of the musical library of the Margrave of Brandenburg didn't even bother to list the now famous Brandenburg concertos. It's even reported that some Bach manuscripts were used as wrapping paper by butchers and merchants in Leipzig. And it was Felix Mendelssohn, 75 years later, who worked tirelessly and successfully for the revival of Bach's music. Mendelssohn's life story is like a little sunshine in the gloomy world of frustration and conflict that plague most great composers. He was born to wealth and position. He was encouraged by his family to develop his talent. He was successful without a struggle early in life. Before his untimely death at 38, practically every Mendelssohn project was successful. Mr. Perret is stepping on stage now. We're going to hear the Bach Suite No. 2 in B minor. Thank you. This concert by the Detroit Symphony Orchestra under Paul Perret's direction has begun with a bow, suite number 2 in B minor. I spoke a little earlier of the almost idyllic life led by Felix Mendelssohn. Before his untimely death at 38, practically every Mendelssohn project was successful, including the restoration of Bach's music to the world. Mendelssohn was even lucky in love. The Concerto for Violin and Orchestra in E minor was finished 3 years before Mendelssohn's death in 1847. He began the work in 1840 and worked on it for nearly 5 years. He was especially concerned that it should play easily and with delicacy, a goal he achieved. There are exquisite grace and polished ease through all three movements. They are played, incidentally, without pause between movements. Arnold Steinhardt, who makes his Detroit debut with this performance of the Mendelssohn Violin Concerto, is 22 years old. He was born in Los Angeles, made his official debut with that city's symphony orchestra at the age of 14. At 17, he accepted a scholarship to study at the Curtis Institute. Last year, he won the Philadelphia Youth Audition and appeared with the Philadelphia Orchestra. He also participated last year in the Casals Festival at San Juan, Puerto Rico. Unquestionably, the highlight of his activities last year was the winning of the 19th annual International Levantrit Competition, the most highly prized award in this country. In 20 years, only 14 award winners have been selected. The contest last year was limited to string players and was judged by a distinguished jury in New York's Town Hall. Mr. Steinhardt won on a unanimous vote and gained the opportunity to appear with the Detroit Symphony, as well as 5 other ranking American orchestras, including the New York Philharmonic, the Buffalo Philharmonic, and the orchestras of Cleveland, Pittsburgh, and Denver. We have just learned that Mr. Steinhardt has an unusually distinguished audience. More distinguished, perhaps, than he realizes, because Jack Benny, who was in Detroit to appear with the Detroit Symphony in a benefit concert, is in the audience. And with him is the renowned violinist Isaac Stern, who is in Detroit for an appearance on another concert series. Mr. Steinhardt, Mr. Perret have walk to center stage now, and they are ready to begin the Mendelssohn Violin Concerto in E minor.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Was the Mendelssohn Violin Concerto in E minor, played by Arnold Steinhardt with the Detroit Symphony under Paul Perret's direction. Our soloist, a tall, rangy young man, slender, full, dark, wavy hair, and Maestro Perret, walked to the wings of the east side of the stage. pianist returns now for a bow. Acknowledges the response of the audience and the members of the orchestra. Now, conductor and violinist. The venerable Mr. Perret, the 22-year-old Mr. Steinhardt, walk to the stage together, shake hands, Mr. Perret smiling broadly. Mr. Steinhardt is a wonderfully poised artist on stage, completely in command of himself and his instrument. Again, the audience's insistence, Mr. Steinhardt returns to the stage. The Mendelssohn Violin Concerto brings us to the end of the first part of the program. In a few minutes, the maestro and orchestra will resume the concert with the Fifth Symphony by Mahler. While the audience here at Ford Auditorium breaks for intermission, we're going to bring you a brief conversation recorded before the concert. I hope you'll enjoy the opportunity to hear the voice of our soloist, Arnold Steinhardt. Arnold, welcome to Detroit and to our microphone.
Thank you very much, Les. It's a pleasure to be here.
I imagine that the highlight of your career so far must have been last year when you won the Leventritt competition.
It certainly was a wonderful thing.
I wonder if you'd tell us a little about the proceedings in a major contest such as the Leventritt.
Well, this competition is held once a year, and although it was held this year only for string players, many years it's held for pianists, and every four or five only it is held for string players. And each entry is required to play representative works from the different periods of musical literature.
I see. It isn't just one piece that you play.
Oh, no. I prepared something like 2.5 hours of different compositions.
I see. And did they then call for what they wanted to hear, the judges?
Yes. You could start with whatever piece you wished, and then after that it was up to the judge's discretion to pick the different things that you had on your list of prepared pieces.
I see. I imagine there was some pretty furious preparation.
Yes.
Practicing.
It certainly was very exciting, too.
I think many of us would be interested in the sort of life a young artist leads. You began your studies early, I presume.
Yes, I'm from Los Angeles, and I had all my musical training till the time I graduated from high school there.
I see.
And from that day, I went to the Curtis Institute of Music in Philadelphia, where I was fortunate enough to get a scholarship. And I was there for 5 years, studying under Ivan Galamian. Mm-hmm. And I just graduated this last May.
Mm-hmm. Is there time for you to have a life outside of music? Do you have any other interests?
Oh, certainly lots of interests. Reading and sports. And just having a good time in general.
I have been curious about your violin. Do you play a special instrument?
Well, it's an Italian violin called a Presenda, and this particular instrument of his that I'm playing was made in 1823.
I see. What about this Mendelssohn Concerto that you're playing at this concert? Does it have any special significance for you?
Well, it's one of my favorites, and it has been ever since, as a young child, I used to listen to it, and I'm very happy to be able to play it with the Detroit Symphony.
Do you have any plans after this concert?
Well, to continue concertizing, I hope.
Mm-hmm.
That's my most important goal, I would imagine, musically.
Well, you have several other appearances to make on the Leventritt circuit, don't you?
Yes, well, I've appeared with all the major orchestras on the circuit except for Pittsburgh, and that will come shortly after my engagement here.
Mm-hmm. There is something in Cleveland.
Yes.
That's new this year, isn't
this year I've become the assistant concertmaster of the orchestra.
Very good. Under Mr. Sell.
That's correct.
Mr. Steinhardt, it's been a great pleasure to talk to you.
Well, thank you, Les. It's been a pleasure to be here.
That was a conversation with a violinist heard on the first part of our program, Arnold Steinhardt. From Henry and Edsel Ford Auditorium, this is Les Martins. Your host is WWJ, the Detroit News, presents the major weekly concert by Paul Perret and the Detroit Symphony Orchestra. In a moment, we'll hear the Symphony No. 5 in C-sharp minor by Gustav Mahler. If Mahler were to have his way, we'd have nothing to say about the work, because he was unalterably opposed to programmatic explanations of his music. One of his biographers writes about a supper party after a performance of his second symphony. Someone brought up the subject of program notes, and Mahler leaped up and said, "Down with program books. They propagate false ideas. The audience should be left to its own thoughts about the work being played. It should not be prejudiced in any manner." That outburst was typical of Mahler. He was a stormy man, an intense artist, a fighter with a will of iron. His life was in every way the opposite of Mendelssohn's graceful, happy existence. The Fifth Symphony, titled The Giant, is a gigantic, impressive work in five movements, divided into three parts. The symphony was first performed in 1904, but revisions didn't end till the last year of his life. In 1911, Mahler was able to write finally, "The Fifth is finished." Mr. Perret now is just a few feet from our microphone here in the wings at Ford Auditorium, ready to make his entrance. We're going to hear now the Mahler Symphony No. 5. That was the Detroit Symphony Orchestra with Paul Perret's reading of the Symphony No. 5 in C-sharp minor by Gustav Mahler. And so, with the Ford Auditorium audience demonstrating its enthusiasm for the performance, our concert ends. Next week, Mr. Perret will conduct a concert performance of Bizet's opera, Carmen, featuring the soloists Jean Madeira, Marjorie Gordon, Ryan Sullivan, and Donald Graham, with the orchestra and the Rackham Symphony Choir. I hope you've enjoyed our broadcast. It was produced and directed by Shields Durkas. And this is Les Martins, inviting you to join us next Sunday afternoon at 3 o'clock when the Detroit Symphony Orchestra is on the air.